Welcome to part two of respiratory. We're going to focus on how to assess the respiratory system. The first part of the assessment of respiratory is our history, asking all the questions related to breathing. Depending on how sick your person is, we could ask a lot of questions or just a few. The important thing to remember is that this body system doesn't function all on its own. It affects everything, so sometimes our questions may cross body systems. The first thing we need to ask them about is their health history. What medical issues do they have or did they have? What kind of childhood illnesses, immunizations, what's their social history and their family history are all important things for us to consider. You also want to ask them about any medications they're taking. Some medications like lisinopril have respiratory side effects that could be part of the problem the person's having. We want to ask them about their lifestyle and their environment. Do they use tobacco products or are they exposed to secondhand smoke? Do they live in an area of high pollution or are they exposed to anything while they're at work? We want to ask them about their diet and exercise habits. And asking about all of these can help us determine their risk factors for respiratory problems, as well as help us determine a possible cause for any problems they might be having. After we get all the information we need about their health history and their background, we can start asking them about the symptoms they're having. We want to know what their normal breathing was like before they started having these changes. We want to know when the symptoms started, how long they've been going on for, and where the symptoms are occurring, like if they're having any chest pain or discomfort. We need to ask them about any aggravating factors that's making it worse or what's making it better, and then what other symptoms are they noticing in their body. We want to know how long the breathing issues have been going on and how long it's been affecting their activities of daily living and the rest of their lives. Some people will complain that they can't do and function normally, and other people will be like, it doesn't bother me at all. We want to ask about any fevers or any coughing or any sputum or chest pain or any dyspnea, or if they're having any fevers or fatigue like at night that could be helping us figure out what's going on. The more information we can get out of these people, the better chance we have at figuring out what's going on. When we assess the respiratory system, a lot of people think we're just doing lung sounds. But remember, the lungs affect everything in our body because they're delivering the oxygen. So we have to look at more than just lung sounds. We need to do our general assessment. We need to look at our patient while they're just sitting there. Do they appear comfortable or do they look like they're in distress? What does their breathing look like? How fast or how slow are they breathing? Are they using accessory muscles? Are they short of breath? Are they wearing oxygen? We want to know what their skin color looks like. Are they pale or are they blue? Or are they pink and they're doing okay? We need to assess their cap refill and assess their nails for any clubbing. We also need to assess the skin color of their extremities. Then we can start taking a look at their chest, starting with inspection. Is their trachea midline? Do you see any structural abnormalities on their chest? Is their chest expansion equal? We may actually need to put our hands on their chest to see if their chest is expanding equally. Next, we can auscultate their lung sounds. Remember, we auscultate anteriorly, posteriorly, and laterally from the apices all the way to the bases of the lungs. We're listening to hear normal breath sounds and to see if there are any abnormal or adventitious lung sounds. Are their lung sounds as loud as they should be, or are there areas where the lungs are softer than we expected? If they're producing sputum, we need to look at it. What color is it? What's the consistency? Is it clear? Is it yellow? Is it green? Is it bloody? And then we want to know what their mental state is like. Are they fatigued? Are they lethargic? Are they restless or are they confused? Restlessness and confusion are often the earliest signs that there's an oxygenation issue. And of course, we have to assess their vital signs, including the pulse ox. And then don't forget that we need to assess the nose, the mouth, and the throat as part of the upper airway assessment. There are three types of normal lung sounds we should be hearing in our patients: vesicular, bronchial, and bronchiovesicular. Vesicular are low-pitched, soft sounds heard during expiration over most of the lung fields. Bronchial are high-pitched and longer sounds, primarily heard over the trachea and those large airways. Bronchovesicular are medium pitched and are heard during expiration over the upper anterior chest and intercostal area. In your Hinkle MedSurg book, under the Resources tab, there are some short videos that play the normal lung sounds, but registerednursern.com has some great videos where you can hear the normal lung sounds, as well as the abnormal or adventitious lung sounds. So I did put that link to her videos on the slide so you can go and listen to them. I think they're pretty helpful. So next we have our abnormal or adventitious lung sounds. We have a couple types of adventitious lung sounds: crackles, wheezes, ronchi, friction rubs, and stridor. Crackles, which are also called rails, are non-musical sounding noises that are discontinuous, meaning they don't happen continuously during the ventilation cycle. Crackles almost sound like Rice Krispies popping in milk, or if you take a couple of strands of hair and you rub them together in your fingers right next to your ear, it sounds like that. We normally hear crackles on inspiration, but we could hear them on expiration as well. What we're hearing in crackles is closed alveoli popping open if they've collapsed, or we're hearing the fluid that's filled up in the alveoli getting moved around by the air movement. This could happen in fluid overload, pneumonia, or obstructive pulmonary disease. We can classify crackles as fine, medium, and coarse, and this really just goes with how loud they are. Fine crackles are very soft and they're very easy to miss if you're not paying attention, and they're usually going to occur in mid to late inspiration. Coarse crackles are much louder, they're hard to miss, and we may hear them through the entire inspiration phase. Wheezes are continuous musical sounding noises that can be heard on inspiration and expiration. And this is why we must auscultate lung sounds during inspiration and expiration. Wheezes are associated with narrowing of the airways, like an asthma or a partial airway obstruction. And that musical sound is actually from the air squeaking its way through the airways. Next, we have ronchi, which are actually classified as a type of wheeze, but they're associated with secretions or fluid in the airways, not like crackles where the fluid's in the alveoli, but this is secretions in the airway. And the ronchi noise is those secretions moving in the airways with the lung, with the actual air moving in the airways. They're usually low pitched. They sound like rumbling or snoring, and oftentimes they'll clear with coughing. If you ever have gotten sick and you were breathing and you could like hear the junk moving in your lungs and you needed to cough to get it to stop, that's ronchi. Next we have friction rubs. Friction rubs sound like a rubbing or grating sound, and they're heard on inspiration and expiration. Usually it's going to be loudest in the bases of the lungs, but sometimes we can hear it over all the lung fields. And these sounds will not clear with coughing, and the sounds will not be there if the person's not breathing. And what friction rubs are caused by is an inflammation of those pleural membranes. So that pleural membrane on the outside of the lungs and then on the thoracic cavity, they're actually rubbing against each other and grating because of a loss of lubrication between those two pleura. They can be very painful as well. And then lastly, we have stridor. And stridor is a high-pitched musical sound that we hear over the trachea in the neck. Stridor is associated with severe narrowing of the trachea in anaphylaxis, and it requires immediate intervention. A person with stridor cannot get enough air in or out of the lungs, and that trachea may actually swell completely shut, which would stop all airflow. There are a lot of diagnostic things we can do to assess the respiratory system. Some of these are above the block one level, but I'm going to list them here on the slide just so you know they exist. But first, we can do an EKG or an electrocardiogram, and we can check out the heart and see how the heart's doing. Remember, the heart and the lungs go hand in hand, so it's kind of important that we check out the heart too. We can do pulmonary function studies or PFTs, which tell us a lot of information about how well the lungs are functioning and how much they stretch. Like how much volume can the lungs take in, how forceful can the lungs inhale and exhale, and how much resistance is in the lungs' stretching ability. We can do capnography, which is a way to measure the exhaled carbon dioxide levels. We can do lab studies on the blood, like arterial blood gases and venous blood gases, which are not a block one topic. And we can do a CBC to measure our hemoglobin levels. We can test the sputum for bacteria and viruses and for the presence of blood or cancer. We can do imaging study like x-rays, CAT scans, and MRIs. The most common imaging study you're gonna see are gonna be x-rays and CAT scans, as they're fast and they tell us a lot of good information about the structure of the lungs and if there are any fluid or masses present. If we need more in-depth detail of the lungs, we can use an MRI, or we can move on to some of the less common imaging studies like fluoroscopy, using radioisotope lung scans, endoscopic procedures where we put a camera down into the lungs and take a peek at them. And we can even insert needles into the lungs and take biopsies of lung tissue, or we can actually remove fluid from the pleural space called a thoracentesis. Typically, we're going to start with the least invasive diagnostics before we move forward to these more invasive procedures like biopsies and endoscopies. And this is the end of part 2.